Hello and welcome. I hope you're as excited as I am that today we get to talk to the authors, the co-authors of the Suffragist Playbook. So we have Lucinda Robb and Rebecca Boggs Roberts here from Candlewick. Thank you very much. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having us. Here. This is a lot of fun.
Well, and I have to say, this is an audience that really loves their books about activism. Yeah, last year at our booth, I did a wall of books about activism and people were taking their pictures in front of it. I mean, social studies teachers love books about resistance. So tell us about your book and what the impetus was, why this book, why now? So yeah, tell us about it.
Well, 25 years ago, I used to work at the National Archives. And at the time we were doing a big project on the 75th anniversary of women's suffrage. And I was working with a lot of original documents that women had sent in to Congress. And one of the things that we got closer to the 100th anniversary, I thought, you know, this is time to do something big, to really recognize what an important movement this was. And obviously a lot has happened since then. Young people are very engaged and very involved, but we wanted to really highlight what people had done hundreds of years before then and the role that they had played and how so many of the things that activists are doing now are things that in many cases the suffragists actually pioneered and that people today can learn from and maybe take their own spin on. And we also wanted to make it something fun and something engaging and hopefully teach a little good history along the way.
Yes,
and that it doesn't surprise me at all that social studies teachers are fond of activism because that's history made real, right? That is the reason this history matters, not just because you should know your history and an educated person should understand America through a historical lens, but also the suffragists won. They affected a massive change to American democracy, and it took a long time. And you know, they didn't resort to armed rebellion. But you can do a lot worse than take their example to make a change yourself. And that is why you should know your history, is to change the world on your own terms.
Absolutely. And you both kind of had a front row to history yourselves. I'll let you tell a little bit about your backgrounds and why and how you know each other and what makes you uniquely qualified to share this story with a new generation of young people.
So our families have actually been friends for generations. My grandmother, Lindy Boggs, and Lucinda's grandmother, Lady Bird Johnson, were young political wives here in Washington. They were both from the South. They both were sort of navigating this post-World War II, or, you know, contemporary with World War II, very heavy on the formal protocol city. And my grandmother really relied on Lady Bird Johnson to show her the ropes. And then they had daughters at the same time. So my mother, Cokie Roberts, and my aunt, Barbara Sigmund, were friends with Lucinda's mom, Linda Robb, and her aunt, Lucy. Actually, Lucinda and my brother were born within a week of each other, this week, in fact, so happy birthday to both.
Oh, happy birthday.
And there is a family legend that they were pledged to each other in the cradle. It did not actually work out that way. They both married other people who are delightful, and they should have married. But then Lucinda and I ended up in college together, and we were at Princeton, where my Aunt Barbara was mayor of the town.
Oh,
and
wow.
She was considering a run for statewide office in New Jersey, and knowing that, you know, people who had grown up in political families knew how to campaign, she got me and Lucinda and Jamie Schroeder, Congresswoman Pat Schroeder's daughter, to come help her out on a few campaign events. So we've known each other a long time.
Well, that's an amazing history. Do you want to add anything to that, Lucinda? Or
I would say one of the things that both of us, because of the position that we've been in, we've had an opportunity to see a lot of politics, as you say, sort of up front and close. I sometimes suggest that I am officially part of the background portrait. But it really has been something that I think makes us believe that you can make a difference, that you can change things. And we've seen activism both be effective and work terribly. And that gives us sort of a long view perspective on it that I think has been helpful for both of us. Also, both of our mothers and grandmothers have always been role models for us. And very specifically, I think both of our mothers have been involved in projects talking about women's history and promoting women's history. Cokie had all these wonderful books that she's written. My mother, when she was First Lady of Virginia, did a project on women's cultural influence in Virginia. And I think that has really sort of seeded down into our generation. It's just a no-brainer for us. Of course women can make a difference. Of course women can have an impact. And I think that's why we both are so behind the project to talk about women's long campaign for women's rights, because really getting the vote is kind of a stand-in for being a full American citizen and mattering, making a difference, being able to change the landscape. So a lot of other things happen. You know, voting is the one that we recognize the anniversary of the 19th Amendment, but so many other things changed in that time period, many of them legal things that changed, like whether women could own, married women could own their own property, and obviously being able to vote, and a whole host of other legislation, but also things that were social norms. I mean, when we first, the time period that we looked at, when women are first getting involved in the 1830s, not only did women not speak in public, and they would get denounced from the pulpit if they did that, they weren't even supposed to applaud in public. You weren't supposed to make any noise at all. And that just really blew me away.
Yeah, I can see that. And one of the things I love about this book is not only do you get this beautiful, rich tapestry of these wonderful women and what they did and learn the history of it, but it really is a playbook. It's like, this is how you translate it into action. So I wanted to ask you a little bit about how you decided to organize it, because it just makes sense the way you've done it. So how did you come up with that structure and fill it in?
Well, when I'd worked at the National Archives in this big project on women's petitions to Congress, obviously we saw not hundreds, not thousands, but literally hundreds of thousands of petitions from women at a time that I didn't know, you know, based on my reading of U.S. history when I was in high school, that women had been very involved. And so I was shocked to find that there were all these issues, starting with abolitionism was a big issue that women were involved in, intemperance, a whole host of progressive legislation, worker safety, doing things for the family and education, all of these other things that women had been involved in through petitioning. And again, although they didn't actually have the right to vote, they could move public opinion. And as I sort of saw that impact that they had over time, I realized, wait a minute, this is really a great list of, you know, this is sort of like art of war, except from how are you going to make this work without warfare? How are you going to do it tactically? And as we started coming together with sort of suffrage history, there were themes that we pulled out and said, this happens again and again and again, and this is how it works. And it really became sort of, you know, I gotta say, it happened very quickly. In a short period of time, we realized, okay, we have to talk about this, we have to talk about this. And it laid out to about 9 sort of distinct different tactics. At one point, we called them secrets of the suffrage movement that we thought really made sense and were easy to understand.
We also decided from the very beginning that we wouldn't elevate these women to bronze and marble and, you know, make them saints that were impossible to emulate. First of all, that's bad history, right? These women were flawed. But also, if what we're trying to do is say you could learn from this movement to become an activist yourself, it's important to understand that these were real life people, you know, who made mistakes, who were slow to learn, whose attitudes might seem wrong or misguided. And sometimes you can learn from their counterexample. And so from the very beginning, we wanted to make it clear that these women were not perfect, this movement was not perfect. But that also means that you, in all of your flaws, all of us, in all of our imperfections, can change the world too.
Yeah, and speaking about the imperfections, you directly address racism and the role racism played in the women's movement, but also just in the history at large. So can you talk a little bit about how you address that in the book? And just tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, so we tried throughout telling the history to bring up the moments when white suffragists employed overtly racist arguments, which they did more often than you might think, fumbled on including African Americans in the movement. And so we wanted it to be sort of a thread throughout the history because, again, we wanted it to be accurate history. But then we also made the decision to sort of call it out in a separate section. And not only did we want to make sure everybody got it, right? but also, this is what good scholarship is for, right? This is, there's no point in just celebrating a movement and pretending it was all wonderful when the real scholarship makes you understand what the limitations were. And Lucinda talks about this as the contrast between what she saw celebrating the 75th and the current centennial celebration, that there's been a lot more attention, particularly on Black suffragists, but other marginalized groups who felt like they were left out of the mainstream, sometimes classist, white suffrage movement. And we look forward to continuing scholarship going forward. There are still a lot of research projects to be done on this movement, and we don't want to ignore those. We don't want to say, oh, but they were fine, you know, oh, but you're judging them through a 21st century lens. That's really punting on an issue that deserves, you know, decent analysis and introspection.
I think you can go back and look at the movement and the mistakes that they made, and I think it's very instructive for ourselves now. And some of the suffragists who I find most interesting, and some of their tactics that I think, wow, we could really use that today. I also learned from what they got wrong. And it's easy, you know, there's some like Kate Gordon, who's just an out, down and out avowed white supremacist. But there are others who probably in their time never would have recognized their own racism. And I think it's useful when we look back at it now to see how it happens, because it turns the mirror on us. It's not just enough to say, we want to look back and judge the people in the past. The idea is, what can we do better now? How can we actually learn from their mistakes and do a better job and try harder and figure out how we can fix things?
Yes, exactly. And I do want to, before we let you go, I want to ask you if you have any ideas or tips for teachers who might want to use this book in the classroom. Things that they can do. How do you see this book being used by young people?
So I've taught a couple of classes about suffrage, because this is actually my second book about suffrage. And I always like to start with asking the students to imagine why anyone would oppose suffrage. Because it's really hard from the lens of 2020 to realize how controversial this once was. And they sort of start with garden variety sexism, right? That the men just didn't trust the women. And then they start to think it through. Who else might have had a vested interest in women not voting? And once you start poking around in the objections to the movement, then you've got a window into teaching the tactics of the movement. And that lesson can be applied to contemporary activists too, right? It's not enough to just say, moral good is on my side. You've got to understand what people fear. You've got to understand why they don't agree with you in order to convince them to change their minds.
I should point out that we are recording this on October, 27th. So this is before the election, and the conference is happening after the election. So just wanted to make sure everyone knows the context we're having this conversation in.
I was going to say, whatever happens, I think we'll all be aware that the fact that women are voting will have a huge impact. When right after women got the vote in 1920, they're really just about a third of the women voted who were eligible to vote. And as far as anyone could tell, it didn't make a big difference one way or the other. Now, over time, as early as the 1960 election, you had more women voting than men. And now in the 2016, I think you had 10 million more women voting than men. So it takes time for people to learn to be voters and get into that habit. But once they do, women really have changed the political landscape.
Well, thank you both so much for writing this book. I feel like we all need to have a suffragist playbook and know how to affect change in our society, whatever age we are. So yes, this was written for young people, but anybody can learn from this. So thank you both so much for taking time to talk with me today, and carry on the good fight.
Thank you so much for having us.